There is a conversation taking place right now that powerfully impacts your life. It did yesterday and the day before. It will tomorrow and the day after as well. This conversation isn't between a group of people, not just one or two. It's a conversation that's taking place, and it has powerfully impacted your life from the very first day the conversation began. And the conversation is the one that is taking place inside your head and inside your heart. We call it self-talk. The power of self-talk is immeasurably great for its influence upon the way that we live, how we go about life, what we think about life, what our general reaction to life is. Self-talk is profound in its implications for how we live and walk as we follow after Jesus. In this series on the power of words, we've been talking about how powerfully this capacity that God has given to us to talk, use words, how powerfully our words impact the world around us. And I'm going to suggest to us today that the power of our conversation that's taking place in our heart and mind, it is foundational. It is the very basic, I believe, of what it means to be a person walking with Jesus, understanding and talking and understanding who I am in Christ. And in that conversation, it has a powerful, powerful effect upon the world around us, around the people around us, for better or for worse. So let's begin by hearing some words of instruction and teaching from a first follower of Jesus. We know him as the Apostle Paul. He wrote a letter to the believers in Jesus living in an ancient city called Philippi. Philippians chapter 4. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any moral excellence, and if there is anything praiseworthy, dwell on these things. Do what you have learned and received and heard from me and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Pray with me, please. Let's pray. Oh, Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations, the self-talk of all of our hearts, may it be acceptable in your sight, Lord Jesus, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Self-talk. The conversation that's taking place within our hearts and minds, the conversation, I don't know when it begins as a child, but at some point we be conscious of the fact that I'm thinking, that I'm considering decisions, I'm considering questions, I'm making choices. And in the conversation that take place inside my heart and my mind, if I understand what that self-talk is about, if I can put it into a framework that is positive and moves me forward, all the better. But I'm also very aware of this, that there's an aspect of our self-talk which can become very harmful, not only to ourselves, but to the people around us, and the way that we follow Jesus. So today we talk about self-talk. It's also called our inner voice. And the inner voice combines conscious thoughts with inbuilt beliefs and biases to create an internal monologue throughout the day. That self-talk begins right from the very moment you awaken to the day. Some would even say it's through the night as you're dreaming. But let's just deal with the daylight hours, the days, the time that we're awake and that we're conscious. This conversation that's taking place inside our mind and our heart is one that is continuous. And for folks who are wrestling with their self-talk, it becomes not a source of joy, but it becomes a source of pain and heartache. So let's understand a couple of questions, actually three of them, about our self-talk. The first question is this. What does your self-talk about God say about you? I'll reframe the question. What is the conversation that you're having inside your head and your heart about the Creator, about God? Now, what is that saying? First of all, let's start with you. What does it say about you? What is the conversation that you're having about God in your head? What does it say about you? A.W. Tozer is a Christian author, one who has written many books, several of which I have read. I came across this quote that says this: what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. So what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. So let's give some examples of that. When we think of God, we might say, God is holy. Oh, and He is. God is holy. How I might reflect upon that can be found in a statement like this: I'm in need of a Savior because I am not holy. God is almighty, and He is. I'm in need of strength because I'm feeling attacked or under pressure. God is good, and He is. I'm in need of assurance of His love because sometimes I doubt. God is sovereign, and He is. I'm in need of certainty because my circumstances are difficult at best and out of control at worst. Or perhaps your thought of God is this: that God is angry. I'm in need of judgment because I rebel against God and His ways. Maybe sometimes you think of God this way: God is indifferent, doesn't care. I'm in need of some means of connection with God because He feels so uncaring. God is, you fill in the blank. And understand that whatever you put into the blank says something about yourself. Now, I think Tozer was right about that, in his idea that what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. And I think Tozer is wise to help us see that what we think about God is a reflection about what's most important to us. Now, I also would challenge Tozer with the idea that what God thinks about me is really what's most important. But for a time, let's consider the question: what does your self-talk about God say about you and your understanding of who you are in light of God, who God is in your life? Second question is this: what does God say about you? In the conversation that's taking place within your heart and mind, if God were to speak into that conversation, and I believe that He does, but if He were to speak into that conversation that's taking place in your heart and mind, what would God say about you? Does he have a word, even a name for you? I want us to consider this, that of the many powerful words that God speaks about us, His children, and when He speaks about you, the word I want us to focus upon is this: beloved. Beloved. A person loved by God. I emphasize this word because I believe it communicates what our self-talk most deeply, desperately needs. We need to know that we're loved. That the God of the universe, the Creator, loves me. And if that truth finds its way little by little, and maybe sometimes with a huge wash of God's love over us, to know that I'm loved by God. Oh, that changes our self-talk in so many good and godly ways. Beloved, this is the word God the Father spoke over Jesus at his baptism. Remember the story? He's there at the River Jordan. His cousin, John, is baptizing people. Jesus came to be baptized by John. John says, no, this is out of order. You should be baptizing me. And Jesus says, no, I'm going to do this. Let's do this. Come on, I want to be baptized. And as he's baptized, as he goes into the water and comes up out of the water, it says that the Spirit of God descended upon him like a dove. And there was a voice from the heavens that spoke and said, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. As Jesus began his ministry, his self-talk, his sense of self and who he was carried along by the word of his Father over him. You are my beloved. With you, I am well pleased. And there was another time later in Jesus' ministry, at an important time where Jesus is transitioning from his ministry, mostly among people who are supportive of him, people who are coming around him. And then as his ministry heads towards Calvary, towards the cross, there's another time Jesus takes Peter, James, and John up onto a mountain. And there before them, Jesus is transfigured before their very eyes. Remember the story? Jesus' outward appearance becomes luminescent. The glory of who Jesus is as the Son of God is seen with earthly eyes. And he's described as dazzling, as bright, and whiter than any whitening agent, any bleach could bleach his clothes. Jesus was seen in his glory. He was transfigured before them. And the voice again comes from heaven and says, this is my beloved Son. Listen to him. And the Father spoke that word over Jesus. You're my beloved. Well, you say, I'm not deserving to be called such a name. Well, it's not up to you to decide what God says about you. Let God be God. If God calls you beloved, that's what he says about you. Consider this. The Apostle Paul speaks of God's choice of mercy over all people in Romans chapter 9. And he goes back into his Bible and he takes from the book of Hosea a statement of God about the people he has chosen. This unrelenting love of God over God's people. This is what he says. As it also says in Hosea, I will call not my people, my people. And she who is unloved, beloved. Now, if you know anything about the book of Hosea, you understand this, that Hosea had been called by God to marry a person who really had nothing to do with God. Anything that she was pursuing was not God. And Hosea, time after time after time, went and brought his wife back to himself. And each time God says, go get her, bring her back. Because God says, Hosea, I love my people, and I want you to love your wife with the same love. And to that woman who continually walked away from Hosea, her name was Gomer, to that woman, Gomer, God says, go and get her, bring her back, love her back into the family. And he says, I will call not my people, and she who is unloved, beloved. So into the dialogue running on in your mind, sometimes it rages like a wildfire, threatening to consume our very sense of self. add this phrase. I am the beloved of God, my Abba Father. You see, that change in perspective begins to take hold in the moments of dark, deep desperation, when the self-talk going on inside of my head becomes a lecture, or I start to chew myself out. And sometimes to the voice that's going on inside of our heads, the conversation that's taking place, comes the voice of the evil one. And he's called the accuser of the brethren. He's called the accuser of the children of God. So if the dialogue that's taking place within my heart and mind isn't bad enough, there can come the force of evil against me and speak in a way that only brings condemnation, only brings judgment, only brings shame. And to that voice, and to the voices that speak within our hearts and minds, comes a different voice. The voice of our Heavenly Father, our Abba Father. And he says, you are my beloved. You're my chosen one. You're my child. I love you. I love you. So how can our self-talk be more closely aligned with what God says about you? And what God says about you is that you are his beloved. Let's keep this in mind. The month of May is Mental Health Awareness Month. You see, even our culture recognizes the great need to address our mental health. And so much of our mental health comes from having a healthy self-talk. The conversation going on inside your head, if it's healthy, that's how you're going to live your life. If the conversation going on inside your head is troubled, is it unhealthy, if it's being persuaded and influenced in a way that is not good for yourself, that can lead to some really hard ways of living. So the science of psychology now recognizes what Scripture has taught for centuries. What we think about influences how we feel. What we feel influences what we do. And Scripture has been talking about the power of self-talk for centuries. And the power of our self-talk dramatically changes the way we live our lives, for better or for worse, because what we think influences what we feel. What we feel influences what we do, for better or for worse. So let's listen again to Holy Scripture. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any moral excellence, and if there is anything praiseworthy, dwell on these things. Do what you have learned and received and heard from me and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. A very positive step in the direction of better self-talk is to be intentional upon how your self-talk is being influenced by internal and external forces. Understand where those voices that are taking place in your self-talk. Understand where they're coming from and identify them as either being of God or not, either being condemning or not, either being shame-giving or not. And understand that when we begin to identify where those words and those conversations are coming from, we can acknowledge them for what they are and what they're not, and stick with what intentionally we know to be true about us as children of God. So, for instance, you may not be able to silence the words of accusation and condemnation you may have endured from an important person who spoke into your life, something that a parent said over you, or about you. And it has stuck in your heart and mind even decades later. The power of that is immense. But understand this. You may not be able to silence those words, but you can begin to redirect those words with a new authority, with a new statement over your life. You can replace them with words that are true, honorable, just, pure, lovely, commendable, morally excellent, praiseworthy, by choosing to change your self-talk. So may I suggest that the conversation that's taking place within each and every one of our hearts and minds, one of the most powerful expression of words that a human will ever walk through, the self-talk that's taking place within our hearts and minds, may I suggest to you that you start with the phrase spoken by God, God the Father over Jesus. And I believe he speaks over you. Simply say this phrase, I am the beloved of God. I'm the beloved of God. God loves me. He loves me. You see, the power of your self-talk, when you open your heart and mind to what God our Father, Jesus our Savior, and the Spirit our Counselor speaks about us and over us. When he speaks about you and over you is life-giving and life-changing. I am the beloved of God. Oh, Father, thank you for this truth. I pray that it would work its way into my heart, into my mind, on those days when the conversation taking place inside is not of you, and it is filled with all those other influences, Lord. Let me come back wisely to what you say about me, what you say about us, Lord. Let each of us have the courage to listen to your word spoken over us, that we are loved by you. And because of that, we can find those things that are true and honorable and worthy and holy and good and commendable. But let us begin knowing that we're loved. And together, God's people said, amen. Oh, amen.